Okay, and then we have a dramatic conclusion here to our series on Nehemiah. We have really taken a significant journey through this book and all that we can kind of grab out of it and digest and learn from it as we are considering aspects of our life that are being built in God. First, we started out as just that video just kind of demonstrated by laying things down before the Lord and honoring Him as the one who will do any sort of building. But we also realized we had to pick up tools that God has given us in order to get started with the process of building. Then when we go to build, we wanted to make sure that we were dedicated to building it strong, whatever it is and what it required in order for those things to happen. And then last week we talked about going back and filling the cracks with the things that God has given us to make sure that it remains intact over time. And then today is a day in which we're going to be talking about what to celebrate, how to celebrate, and why to celebrate the things that God has done with Raised It High. Now, speaking of things to celebrate, one of the neat things that we have available to us now, and only have had available since 2007, is that we actually have been able to excavate the wall of Nehemiah that we've been talking about this entire time. It's actually there, and you can see it. And how this happened was there was a tower that was kind of crumbling a little bit, and they wanted to go and repair a tower that was on the site of the wall around Jerusalem. And at the bottom of the tower was a burial of dogs, which is common in the time of the Babylonian takeover of Judah. And so they went to excavate and date the remains of the dogs that were in this burial plot. And two things happened. One, when they dated the remains, they found out that the tower was actually much older than they expected. They thought that it was about the same time era as what would have been the Persian period, which is when the Nehemiah wall was built. At the same time, the other thing that happened too is that while they were excavating this little grave, they actually started to find other stones beside and underneath the tower. And so they kept on excavating and kept on excavating and kept on excavating. And what they discovered was the wall of Nehemiah. And we have a photo of it right up there. Here.
Wow.
Yeah. Isn't that amazing? Look at it. Look at the size.
Wow.
Look at the scale. Look at how big the stones are. Look at how tall it is. Remember, this is almost 3 miles long. Now, what's amazing, what's incredible about it is summed up in one verse in Nehemiah 6, verse 5, that says this. When you look at this, this is what it says. It says, "So the wall was completed on the 25th of Elul in 52 days.
Wow.
3 miles long, that scale, in just 52 days. How amazing. How incredible. How did those people, yes, there were thousands of them, but how did they accomplish such a feat by hand with basic tools? How were they able to rebuild the wall and do it in such a way that we could still go and see it standing even today? How was that possible? Well, it's a beautiful feat. It's pretty amazing. It's definitely something to celebrate. However, here's the main idea of today's message. Even when we work against all odds to achieve something, the glory for its accomplishment belongs to God alone.
Amen.
Even when we're working, even when we're building, and I'm sure if you've been with me along in this series, you've probably thought about a bunch of different things regarding your life, your career, your marriage, your relationships, your family, regarding our church, whatever it might be that you're considering and talking about when you're thinking about building, what God's put on your heart. You're probably like, yeah, I've prayed, I've gone after it, I've worked, I've put in lots of time. And in fact, there may be things in your life that you look at and say, oh, it's beautiful, I know that it's a great accomplishment, things that, yes, you probably are proud of, and that isn't necessarily a bad thing. You're proud of the fact that it was done, but anything that we see in our lives, anything that we see that is truly beautiful and is truly worthy of like a representation of something that you didn't think could even happen, but here it is, whatever it might be, God is the one who should get the glory for it. Now, there are three truths Three things that we think about raising it high. We think about raising God's glory. We think about glorifying Him and exalting Him in the way that He deserves, just as we did it in worship today. There are three truths that I wanted to share with you. First is this: the glory of God is raised high when we truly unify in Him. Now we're going to break down Nehemiah chapter 8. One thing I did want to say about this particular chapter is that, have you ever talked to someone and they're really excited, and when they're excited and they're recounting something, it seems like they go all over the place? Like they start to tell you, like, oh, you know, you wouldn't believe what happened to me the other day. And then they start telling you, and it's a really good story, but then they say, oh, wait. And you got to know that this happened as well. And then they skip down to the next part there at the other end. You're trying to keep up with them. You know, it's a really good story, but it kind of goes in and out. And things like, anybody ever know anybody like that that kind of talks like that? I know several people like that. You know, I'm like that sometimes, actually. So this is the way Ezra, who's the scribe that actually recorded the events of Nehemiah, as well as the book of Ezra, kind of like that. So he's really excited in remembering and recalling this incredibly momentous day when the wall was built. So he tends to skip around. So what I've done today as we're going through it is to make sure that we kind of go through it a little bit more chronologically so that we can make sense of it as we go. So let's continue with the scripture here. The glory of God is raised high when we truly unify in Him. I'm going to start in Nehemiah 8:4. It says this: Ezra, the teacher of the law, stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. So raised it high, placed him on a big wooden platform, kind of literally there. Okay, now let's go back to 1:8:1, and it says this: all the people came together as one in the square before the water gate. Let's stop right there for just a minute. What I love, I actually like the King James, actually, and that says it like this. It phrases it like this. It says, all the people came together as one man in the square before the water gate. It kind of describes that they were so together. They were so unified in what they had experienced. The process of getting that wall done had put so much in common between them that it was like they moved like one person together. They were completely unified at that moment. Now, here's what's interesting. If you look at our world, you look at where we live, the culture, and so on, it seems like a lot of people, when they talk about unity, they all say that's a good thing. We want unity. But it's amazing how many people stand up to kind of, almost like they're the ones that know the way to become unified. But they don't do it with the very thing that they need, which would be the God, which would be a relationship with Him. And so what happens is, what? They're talking about unity, but what do you end up with? Greater division. Greater separation according to whatever group might be identified for whatever might reason. They're saying we need to become unified, but the more they talk about it, it seems like the more apart everything becomes. And why is that? Because they aren't basing their efforts of unity. They aren't able to raise it high. They might be able to build it to a certain point. They might be able to build things to a pretty good place, but they aren't able to get it all the way to a place that is actually something you look at and say, that glorifies God, because they're ignoring one important point. And let's move on, one important element, and let's move on from that part of 8:1 into the second part. It says this: they told, that's the people moving as one, this is, they told Ezra, the teacher of the law, to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So imagine that a bit. So he's up there on the platform. Said that all of us in a room, okay, had just done something that amazing. Built this thing in 52 days, all right? Now, if you saw me get up in front of everybody, you might be thinking, okay, he's going to start thanking people. He's going to start saying, thank God. Yep, he's going to start thanking the different families that helped build this thing and their contributions and so on. Maybe make a little speech. But it says this: the people said to him, they said, hey, take out the book of the law of Moses. Get out the Bible. Get out the scripture, Ezra. Start with that. They had come to a point where they understood that the Word of God is the only way they're going to truly be able to exalt, to raise it high, to truly celebrate all that God has done. And go and just describe this, even in terms of the solution to those things that we see in our culture, in our society, where there's so many different people who talk about unity. Even within us, when we have broken relationships in our homes and so on, what is the key that we need in order to be able to see true unity? In my pastor that I came to Christ under, Bishop Joseph Garlington, was a famous worship leader in addition to being a preacher. He was a worship leader for Promise Keepers years ago. Promise Keepers was a ministry that went all over the country and for men. And one of the things that Promise Keepers was dedicated to was racial reconciliation. Now, my pastor, Bishop, he is a black man. The church that we attended was almost evenly split. This is in the late 80s, and it was like 51% black and 49% white. I mean, it was truly extraordinary, especially in those days, to see that kind of an experience. And this is one of the things that he used to say. He said, and he became famous for this statement, went all over the world. It says this: in a divided society, only the church can model unity. In a divided society, the only people anywhere that are going to truly be able to model unity, no matter what anybody talks about, are the people who know and honor the word of God, and that is what enables us to be able to exist in a place of true unity. Now, that brings me to the second truth of how God's glory is raised high. The glory of God is raised high when we truly honor the word of God. Nehemiah 8:5. Let's talk a little more about how much those people honored the word of God. Remember, Ezra gets up there and they say, get out the scriptures we've got. The first five books of the Bible, the books of Moses, get them out. They yell for him to do that. And then this is what happens, 8:5. Ezra opened the book. Now, it's probably animal skins. It might have a binding, but it would all be made out of animals at that time. And maybe some papyrus, very, very thin, very precious. This would be the only one in all of the city. They may have had more, actually, back in Babylon than they did in Jerusalem at that time. There is a preciousness to what he is doing right now with the book of Moses. It's the only one they've got. Ezra may have been the one to write it himself, to translate himself, to put it down. This is significant. And he opens it. He may roll it out. Or maybe there's a binding. I don't know. But either one was possible at that time. This is Ezra opened the book, and then it says, all the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. They weren't asked. They weren't instructed. And remember, all he did at that point was open it. And they stood up. And then it says, Ezra praised the Lord, the great God. And all the people lifted their hands and responded, amen, amen. And when he said that, then they bowed down and worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Now back up to 2, where it kind of talks about what happened from that point. In 8:2, it says, so on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. And he read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. So he opens it. They stand. He says a quick praise. They bow down and worship. I would assume that maybe they sat back, maybe they didn't, maybe they stayed with their faces to the ground and continued to worship while they read. But this is what that says, that they read it for five hours, and they listened the entire time. And these are the books of the law. This is the first five books of the Bible. This is the books of Moses. So you're talking about some wonderful narratives. You're talking about the stories of the creation. You're talking about the stories of Abraham and Jacob. You're talking about Noah. You're talking about really good stuff. Joseph, all those things are really good things. But it's also talking about who was associated with the tribes of Israel and how they all gathered by clans and the names of all the people, the accounting of all the people. All 367 laws is listed in Leviticus and listed on, read through all of that stuff for 5.5 hours, and everyone, men, women, and all who could understand, which means young children, sat there for over 5 hours and just listened. How much they honor the word of God. So when we want to raise it high in your life, if there is something that you are trying to build, in your family, if you are trying to build something that is going to be glorifying to God, if you have a dream of what you want want your life to be like, if you have anything, then it has to start by understanding that it must be rooted based upon the scriptural word of God himself. It is worthy of all honor. Now, why I think this must be difficult for us is because, as I mentioned, that Bible, the book of the law that he had, would have been exceedingly rare in that time. We think about it even today. We may hear stories of the underground church in communist China, where they may not even have, some of the groups, they not have a full Bible. They only have, in some cases, a few pages of the Bible. And they read it over and over again. They risk their lives. They risk prison to be able to be together, to be able to read that word together, even though they don't even have the whole thing. The rarity of it makes it special. And it's good to hear those things, because it reminds us of how wonderful something is, how wonderful the word of God is. Because if people are willing to do that in other places, am I just taking the word of God that's so accessible to me for granted? And there is definitive discipline in that. Because if you think about it, yeah, the word of God is definitely plentiful here, right? It's plentiful. We have it in online and so many sites and Google and so many different places and so many different tools and things that are just available anytime I want them, where I used to have to buy them in a store. Now I don't have to. The word of God is available in apps. It's in our phones. The word of God is everywhere. I ordered a new study Bible for myself just a couple of days ago. When I'm excited to have, I'll have it like tomorrow. I mean, and there are Bibles sitting around this sanctuary, just laying on chairs, laying on the floor. There's a Bible everywhere, but just because something is plentiful doesn't make it any less crucial. Think of it like water, right? Drinking water, clean water, right? Running water. Thank God we have it. Thank God it's everywhere here. Today, after church, we'll clean up another dozen half-drunk bottles of water from around the sanctuary that people just left behind. It's everywhere. Thank goodness for that. Our well pump broke just a few weeks ago. And we had no running water for like 3 days. And we thought we were going to die. It was just so awful and so gross. And just, we went over to my daughter's and had a shower. It was like the greatest shower that in such a long time. So because we didn't have it, it made us appreciate that so much. But here's the thing. Just because water's everywhere, if anyone in this room made the decision to say, I'm not going to drink it anymore, I'm just not going to have water, and I'm not going to have anything made from water, which means anything, guess what? You're not going to last but a couple of weeks before you would die. Just because water's everywhere doesn't make it any less crucial. Just because you can get the word of God anywhere doesn't make it any less necessary for your very survival. And if you want to build something high in your heart, there should be an extreme honor for the word of God when it's even opened. And the word, whether it's in your phone or whether it's a Bible that you open up, every single day you should make absolutely certain. You want to build something that isn't just good, you want it to be great. You want it to be something that truly glorifies God, that represents something that's in your family, in your life, in any capacity, in our church, then we need to honor the word of God above everything, to the degree that if it was a hot day and we were all together just outside, someone could stand up there and just read it, and we would honor it enough to listen to every single word, knowing that it is life-giving to us. We choose to honor We choose to raise it high when we honor the Word of God. And then let's go on and talk about this final sequence, probably the most beautiful aspect, the little truth that comes out and what happens next with the people in the time of Nehemiah. It says, the glory of God, here's the truth, the glory of God is raised high when we choose to celebrate. Here's what happens. Verse 9 says, then Nehemiah the governor, Ezra the priest, and the teacher of the law, and the Levites who were instructing the people, said to them all, after reading it for 5 hours, they said, this day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people have been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Why were they weeping? Well, some of it did they just come out of their honor. But I think that it came out of a source of conviction as they listened to it. So the Word of God is a double-edged sword that separates our flesh and our spirit, and even our soul. It slices through and gives us definition on that which is most important in our life. But I think it was much, much more plain on that day in this way. Remember what I've taught you. You've been with me through this series. About 140 years since the Hebrews were taken into Judah was taken into captivity by Babylon. But then you had about 90 years since the first grouping of people came back from Babylon to reestablish Jerusalem. So it's been 90 years. And remember when we first started, that was represented by our wall. We had all the crumbled bricks and rocks thrown everywhere. So it was total devastation. So it was just when they got there, when Nehemiah gets there, the walls are just completely decrepit and destroyed. He couldn't even get through certain portions of the wall because of it. That means for 90 years, even though they had returned, they had lived within that. For 90 years, they had lived in a place that was poor, that was devastated, that was subject to attack, and it was. That they were victimized, that they were in squalor. That they were in poverty, and for 90 years, generally feeling that way. And then remember how we started this? Remember that we said that the wall was built then in 52 days? And they had just spent hours listening to all the triumphant stories of all that God had done for the Israelite people, for the Hebrew people, all those beautiful stories of these supernatural things that God had done. And if I were there looking at this wall that was built in 52 days, knowing that we had just lived a certain way for 90 years, I'd be sitting there and I'd be thinking, why didn't I pray? Why didn't I try? Why didn't I believe this could happen sooner? How much of God did I forget? How little faith I have shown? And it would cause me to mourn and to weep. Here's the thing, the Bible instructs us that when we get to heaven, that our lives are going to be quote-unquote, judged. Now, I don't think it's in the sense of like people think of judgment, like because we're in heaven, so I mean, what could happen? You know what I mean? I think it's more like a review with God, you know? Let's talk about what I had planned for you. Let's talk about what I had ideally planned. And while there won't be a devastating regret, here's my guess. I think that for most of us, we won't get up there and see that we prayed for too much. I think most of us will get up there to see the ideal plans of God, and we'll realize that we asked God for way too little. And so we see things in our life, we see great things that God has done. We want to raise it high. What should that cause in our heart and in our lives? A desire to continue to pray for the biggest thing. Even beyond our challenges, even beyond our problems, to look beyond them, to not be willing and satisfied to just sit in a circumstance of devastation, no matter how long it has gone on, but to raise it high, to raise up our faith, to believe and to know that God is not only capable, but desires to set all things right. And if he does so, it doesn't mean that it has to take the rest of our lives to do it. He can change things instantly. And anything that we stand here today considering impossible is absolutely possible with God. No matter what the past shows us, no matter how long it's been, to know that in an instant, in a short period, it can change. Nehemiah was one man. He was one man, sent with a few soldiers and some letters from a king. And in 52 days, he reversed 90 years of devastation. The faith of many together, therefore, what can be compounded and created in this world? People are saying in this world, people are claiming that people are moving away from God. They're moving away, and we've got to be really careful now in the way in which we approach things, because there's just such a gap between where people are in their hearts and their mind and the church and things of God. But here's what I want to share with you, a beautiful thing that God has done. In the midst of all these studies and all these things that have been declared about how people have moved away and there's less people that are interested in God, I don't believe it. You know why? Because here in this church, in the last 8 weeks, we've added nearly 100 people to our attendance. Not because of me, it ain't because of anybody else. I mean, as much as I love and I honor my staff, it is not because, are we working? Sure, but the glory goes to God for that. And here's the thing, if it can happen here, it can happen anywhere. So this is what I would declare, because God is so great, because God is so amazing, because he is so loving, he is turning the hearts of people back to him. I'm seeing more and more people get on their knees, believe God for what they have left behind, and they want to come to see something that is completely different than what the world offers. This is a time and a season that God is doing a new thing, and the devastation, no matter how long it has lasted, is no longer going to remain, because walls are going to be built and amazing things are going to happen in remarkably short periods of time. The experts who have said, no, it can't happen that way, people are moving away, you need to be careful about the way in which you talk about the Holy Spirit, or the way in which you honor and worship the Holy Spirit, the ways in which you engage people, because you don't want to scare anybody else off. I am saying that they are deceived. I think that is the very things that God has given us to share his love with the world, is the very same things that appealed to and added thousands by day to the people in the time of the book of Acts. In the same way that it was in the time of Nehemiah, the same people with the same conditions and the same human hearts, loved by the same God who was powerful and mighty and capable of building huge structures and gatherings of people that can come together and do amazing things and raise it so high that it is impenetrable to any attack of the enemy and any culture. I believe God is doing it. I believe he's going to do it. There is no doom. I do not believe that we are doomed to a life and a world that is just going to fall and crumble even further and further. I don't care about the devastation that's happened. In fact, I would say that it was at the time, I don't think it's a coincidence, that it was at the time that these claims began to be said and began to be made among our people in our own country as an example. Even spiritual leaders that were saying these things. It was at that time that people began to go to church less. It was at those times that people began the culture began to crumble around us. And I am saying that that is now reversed. I am saying that now those trends have now ended. And I believe that as we do the things that God has done, as we honor God with all of our hearts, as we honor his word with our hearts, as we place our faith in him, as we desire to see it raised high, and as we don't stop or hesitate from presenting God in the loving and powerful way that he is in our lives and our hearts, and we build with our families and build as a church, the more that we do that, I believe that it won't change just things for people in here, but it can change and bring revival to an entire region, to an entire nation. I believe that God will do that. I believe that God can do that. I believe that God is doing that. Amen. And I believe suddenly then people are going to rise up and they're going to start to make studies and they're going to say all of these people are returning to the Lord. All of these people are coming to God who weren't with them before. The churches that are most dependent upon him and those that are reflecting his love, they're supernatural, praying after miracles and going after God and believing these things. Putting time in, loving one another, forming relationships and believing in, these are the ones that are growing. And I believe that it's going to sweep across this country and across this nation. I truly, truly believe it.
Amen.
Now, the one last point I want to make. Talked a lot about walls. This is kind of related to what I just said. Talked a lot about walls. Made this here as this last and final example here of raising the high out of the crumpled bricks that we had before. Talked about weapons. Weapon is still here, stone and the sword, because even though the wall was built, it actually says that they continued to face opposition even after it was built. We talked about these things, but you know what? It was never about the wall. It was never about the weapons. It's never about the stones and the swords. It's all about what's produced in our hearts and in our life. It's all about the things that God does, the things that he creates around us. When we look at our families, when we look at our careers, we look at our churches, we look at anything that we desire to build in our lives, it's never about those individual circumstances. What is the focus of God is what arises in our hearts as a result of whatever we're facing. And the beauty of the miracles that he produces along the way, so that in our minds and in our hearts, in every season, no matter what we face, in our families or wherever else we're building, the things that we recognize that are worthy of raising it high.
Amen.
In our hearts and our minds. It's what it's all about. Finding more and more and greater things to glorify him with and through. So, as we move through this time here, there's one key thing that is necessary for all of us to be able to truly participate in something that is worthy of being raised high. There's maybe some of you here today that you're here because, you know, mom made you come. Mother's Day. There may be some of you here today and, you know, you've been away from God for a while. There hasn't been much in your life that you can look at and say, yeah, raise it high and glory to God, because you've been away from him thinking. Maybe you fell into some of the deceptions that have been spoken about how it's not relevant to be able to come to church or to be able to place faith in God any longer, than somehow you can raise and build without him. If that's you and you are hearing me today and you're like, I need to return to God, or I need to come to him, here's one change of paradigm I want to put in your mind. God put on my heart as I was just getting ready for today, just spoke to me. There's someone here in our services today, and you've used this phrase, you haven't been with God, you haven't placed your faith in Jesus as your Savior, but you'll say, one of the things you said is, well, it's because we're all children of God. And I need to correct that for you on the basis of what the Word of God himself says. We're not all children of God. If you don't believe in him, then you're just a creature of God. You've been created, but you're not his child. The only way you become the child of God is if you confess that he is your father. And then through a spirit of adoption, he claims you as his own. You need to make that commitment in your heart. You need to say that he's your father, to lay your life down before him and to ask him to take it. Those are the things that are required for you to be truly a part of the family of God and truly able to build what might be good into that which might be great, because now you have his supernatural power that can make anything possible. Now, the great news is that it's really simple. You want to make that commitment. It's just that you recognize that you're a sinner. Like all of us are sinners. And then you recognize that what Jesus did on the cross, when he died on the cross, he did it so that you wouldn't have the consequences of your sin in your life anymore. So that you have faith in that. And then you also put faith in the fact that he raised from the dead. So that now all the blessings of all of heaven can come down into your life. And all of that supernatural influence of God can be a part of all that you do. It's a real simple prayer. I'm going to ask you to pray it in just a minute. For all of us, I'd ask that you're going to repeat after me. But first, let's put our hand over our heart. And let's just bow our heads. I'm going to ask them, guys, just listen. Just listen to God. Just take a minute. Okay, speak something to you. I think God wants to speak to some people here. He always wants to speak to his kids, but I think he wants to speak to some people here about some things that you stopped believing for, that he wants you to believe in again. Some devastation that you've been sitting in for a while, that he has no will or desire for you to remain in for a single day longer. There's some dreams. Some of you are saying to yourself, you're too old for dreams. But you're not too old. Joel says that in the last days that he will pour out his spirit upon all flesh so that the old men will dream dreams, young men will see visions. What's he saying to you now? It's your Father speaking to you. What does he want you to build to raise high in your life? Alright, now everybody, I want us to, let's praise God. Let's pray to God. I just want you to repeat after me. Affirm your faith. Step into your faith if you need. Lord Jesus, I confess that I am a sinner. But I believe you died for me on the cross. Thank you for forgiving me. Thank you for rising from the dead and opening all of heaven to me. My life is yours, God. Raise it high. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you've never said that prayer or a prayer like it before, then all of heaven and every angel is praising God in this moment. They're rejoicing that you have come to him, and they're rejoicing that you've come back to him, saying your name in praise. Now, as our last act together in this service, to raise it high, we're going to glorify God again in worship. I'm going to ask that you stand together. Let's worship God, and then I'll bless you. Veterans Day for the Testifier service. There are church services all over the place, sure. That doesn't make them any less crucial. I encourage you to come on out. Take the time to honor God with your life. I guarantee you, you're going to love it and be thankful that you did. Also, moms, grab a muffin on your way out. We love you. We bless you all. Father, I thank you so much, Lord. I thank you, Father, for every single person here. I thank you, Father, for your love upon them. Lord, I pray that as they move forward from this place, this path that we've all been on together, as we're building, as we're seeking you, as we're glorifying you, Father, I pray that we would not become satisfied this week. I pray, Father, that everyone here would continue to build, raise it high, have expectations upon a supernatural God that cannot be limited by any philosophy of this earth. And I pray, Lord, that as they move forward, they know and sense your love, and they hear your words directly to guide them as they face the next challenge to build and raise it high. And in all of it, we will give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.